Say when.
Welcome back to Counterculture.
I'm Pastor Mark, and this is Pastor Andrew. I know you don't like that, but I'm going to call you that anyway.
It makes me feel more important for a second. And then I go, yeah.
Really,
yeah.
Is that your section of the sidewalk? Are we talking about that today?
You just stay on your side. I'll stay on mine, and there will be a line. And if you step on the crack, you will...
break your mother's back. No, right. We do not believe those things. We negate that, and we renounce it. In the name of Jesus.
Here we go. Acts chapter 5.
Can I read? Pick me.
Great. All right. Acts chapter 5, please. Read 12 through 15.
You bring out the most fun in me, Andrew.
Ooh. I love that.
You bring out the child in me. Which doesn't take much, but
is that a Hallmark card?
It could be.
I love you.
The apostles. You. I am reading.
Got it. Sorry.
Get serious now.
Dead serious.
The apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by evil spirits. And all of them were healed.
So we don't talk about this section a whole lot in churches today, right? We don't talk about it in Christendom today.
No.
This is a crazy, crazy scene, right? Peter and company are healing people. They're doing all kinds of things. And people get so desperate, they bring their sick loved ones in hopes that just maybe Peter's shadow would lay on them and heal them, right? All this stuff going on. So God,
come on.
You were talking. You were talking last counterculture. So you do not want me to get going. Like this will be a 25-year counterculture, right? First of all, this whole section is fascinating to me because these are the fishermen, the tax collectors, the zealots, the crazy people, the lower than low people doing amazingly.
Commoners.
Yeah.
Ordinary men.
Doing crazy things.
Right?
Doing crazy things. But here's my question to you. Seemingly, these people wanted that which Peter had, and they were willing to settle for what Peter had rather than Peter himself, right? They didn't want an encounter with Peter, or they thought they weren't going to be able to have an encounter with Peter. So they were just willing to take whatever they could get, right? So when we talk about counterculture, one of the things that is happening in our culture today is this very thing. We have people who come to church, they want the things of church without the people of church, without the pastor, without being a part of church. They just want a benefit. I don't feel well today. My granny is sick. My grandpa is in the hospital. I want the things of God. I want these people to be healed. I want my marriage to be fixed. I want my job to get better. I want my finances to get better. Whatever it is, I want the things. I hope that Christ's shadow just somehow falls on me. I just really don't want Christ. I don't really want Jesus. I don't really want church. I don't really want the pastor. I know where he is, and if I need the things of him, I'll call him up and say, hey, pastor, can you come do this funeral? Can you come do this wedding? Can you pay my rent? Exactly. Can you pay my rent? We're a culture that is heading down this. It works that way in everywhere. We don't want relationship. We want the things. But we are called to be counterculture. We're called to be different, right, as Christians. How do we avoid, how do we stop intentionally from being caught up in this humongous vacuum cleaner of this type of thinking where the things of God are what we want rather than being part of the kingdom?
I was just looking at some notes from my wife's ordination service and general superintendent of the Church of Nazarene, Gustavo Crocker, was talking about holiness. It was like camp meeting. It was like an old camp meeting, which was supposed to be, it was an ordination service, but it was like camp meeting. I mean, there were people amen and everything else. It was wild. They weren't running the aisles and hooting and hollering yet, but they were.
But they were close.
But I was reading over the notes that someone in my church took who was there, because I was trying to be a husband to my wife who was getting ordained. And I was looking at these yesterday, and there was a wonderful thing that Gustavo Crocker said, Dr. Crocker said, regarding holiness, people want the blessing more than they want the blesser.
Ooh, that sounds like a word I would use.
They want all the benefits, but isn't that how our culture is today?
That's exactly right.
I don't want to commit. So what are we saying? We say nothing says commitment like, no, I won't marry you. We'll just live together. We're going to commit to the... No, you're not. Let's just call spade a spade. No, you're not.
But you're
expressing... Commitment says you walk down that aisle and you say, I'm going to be with you the rest of my life till death do us part. That is a committed relationship. Not, oh yeah, we're just going to live together at the restaurant. That ain't committed.
No, that's if I want to walk away, I can walk away.
I can walk away.
Right.
You know, because and without any consequences. Mm-hmm. Except for now, that's even becoming where there's consequences because, oh, well, I'm going to take you to court over this, that, or the other thing. And so, yeah, we don't want to... I was in college, mm-hmm. and I was getting grant money and scholarships.
Mm-hmm.
A buddy of mine said to me, he goes, how are you getting all this grant money? I said, I fill out the forms. The applications. I ain't doing that, he said. I said, then you ain't getting the money.
It's good. Kind of the way that works.
Here's the thing. If you are a college student listening, you can make probably $500 to $1,000 an hour just by filling out one scholarship, grant application, financial aid application an hour. If you did that one a day and you got $500, I haven't worked anywhere since then that got me $500.
A day.
A day.
Yeah, nope.
And it took me maybe an hour to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I've never made $500 an hour beyond that. We don't want to pay the price. We don't want to do anything. Just give me what I want. Now there's this thing. I was talking to a lady from a church that has one of those clothing sheds.
Mm-hmm.
And they were having trouble. People break into mine. They had people breaking into mine. Okay. And they don't just break in. They vandalize them. They tear them apart.
Yep.
They caught their lunch because they brought the police in, as have I. Because a couple of reasons, I've had people shooting up in my shed.
Yep.
I don't want to go in there and find someone dead in the morning. I want them to be safe. I've had people stay in them at night in the winter. I don't want to go in there and have to thaw someone out in the morning.
Yep.
Okay, I want you to be warm. You know, so I don't have the resources to put them up for the night over. So the cops do. So I call with it. The one guy was really cool. He had warrants out for his arrest, so he was warm that night. But they had people bash him on paper. Well, you should be helping people. We will help people. But knock on our door and say,
Yep.
So I have a lady in my church who lives in a really rough neighborhood. She goes over and meets her new neighbor, and the first thing he says, can I have $5? No, you cannot. How about you be a good neighbor? You know, and work for something?
That's the definition of being a good neighbor now is give me $5.
Give me $5, you know. So I'm going to start asking, I was going to ask you for $5. You know? Where is the sense of responsibility, the sense of contributing? We see this all the time. Now you got me on a soapbox. So now we're going to be here 50 years. You're 25 years, my 25 years. I preach to my church all the time. There's a point when you come in as a consumer that I need Jesus' help.
Yep.
But there comes a point when you also have to be a contributor.
Yep.
You have to give something.
Or be producing something.
Right. You have to be producing something because you know what? If we're all coming in, it's called a parasite.
Yep.
And if you're not contributing and all you're doing is taking, then you're a parasite. Mm-hmm. And here's the thing. Work is good for people. It gives you and I were talking about something I did last night. I fixed a step on my chicken barn and I fixed an umbrella on our deck. You know what? I was like, I just didn't sit in front of the TV tonight, or I just didn't, waste my time. So I actually did something productive, and I was like, and I fixed it. I did that.
You produced.
I produced. I was like, what else can I break and fix?
Funny, because I was in Erie the other day going by, and there was a homeless person with a sign on the corner, right? It looked like a very able-bodied person, right? Wasn't in a wheelchair, wasn't in anything. As soon as somebody rolled down their window, they were hopping into the road to get something, like type of thing. But the question was raised, well, wait a second. Every single store around here we're hiring, right? So you're looking at it and going, well, this person wants resources without having to work. Now, again, might have had a total legit reason.
Sure, sure. You don't know.
But the statistics say that a lot of people
who they'll say no to an odd
that
job
are homeless yeah. are homeless because they want to be.
Yeah. Right? And panhandling is a wonderful profession. Mm-hmm. They make good money. You don't see them in the winter around here.
No, no.
They've gone south. And some of them have very nice houses from what I understand. Yeah. Research. Oh, I know. I'm a bad guy because I just said that. But it's...
But they want this... It's this whole idea of, listen, we want the things of Peter without a relationship with Peter. Right? And again, I think that... I think going back to your marriage analogy, right? I certainly think that there are people who are getting... Who are living as if they're married, mm-hmm. getting the benefits. I mm-hmm. also think that the flip side of that works. There are people... who are getting married on paper, but don't really want any kind of commitment, don't want any kind of...
How many fathers out there, and we know this is true, because mm-hmm. statistics, they are fathers because they have sired a child, but they are not fathers. Yeah. They're nowhere... They might be there, but they're not dads.
Yeah.
Yep. They're not dads. Or as one guy in my church told me, he says, I don't know who my dad is. He goes, he was a sperm donor. I know. Pardon me if that bothers anybody. It's biology. It's not anything nasty. He goes, that's all he was a sperm donor. He goes, I don't know who he is. I have no idea who he is.
Now you want me... See, now I'm going to get in trouble because now I really want to preach a sermon that's called, Is God Your Sperm Donor?
Ooh!
Right? Like, because that is a fantastic sermon, right? That's
well,
what it
okay,
is.
So,
that what you want of God.
So years ago when I was in another state pastoring, and we had a compassionate center. And I remember the guy who ran it talking to me. He goes, Pastor, we can evangelize, but we don't always disciple.
Yeah.
There's a lot of homeless people that they'll accept Christ, but they don't either want to or don't have the mental capability to be discipled because of whatever. They don't get, I can't change, this is all I know kind of thing, okay?
I want
without to... So there's this idea, sometimes we have people who, they pray the prayer, which we know is biblical, of course. We pray the prayer, but they're not following Christ. They are nominal in Christianity at best.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I prayed a prayer. I believe. I've heard that one. I heard that one this week. Well, I believe. Well, what do you believe? The devil believes in Jesus.
The demons believe and shudder.
Yeah, and shudder. what do they know that we don't?
That's exactly. We don't even get to the shudder part.
We don't get to the shudder part.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of people who want the marriage certificate without the marriage.
I had a friend one time. He would make the comment. He goes, well, she's married. I'm not.
Yep.
Well, what?
Yep.
Wait, what?
Yep. But again.
And this business of it's 50-50. No, it's not. It's 100%, 100%. You're either all in or you're not.
Now you're going to make me preach about teeter-totter. So, no, we're going to have to do it. Right? Listen, obviously, there's a lot to talk about here. Right? The whole idea is, you know, do you want the things of God?
Exactly.
Without God? Do you want the things of God and God? And by the way, would you be willing to take God without the things of God?
Exactly.
There's a whole bunch to unpack in that whole thing. So I'm sure that Pastor Mark and I will be back to visit that at a different moment in time. We may be dressed alike and we may not be dressed the same. So we'll see you next time on...
No idea what that means.
Counterculture.
Grace and peace.